Thanks, Jenny, for a nice introduction. And indeed, very happy to be here with you today and to present a bit about, well, the work on the influence of compositional factors on dairy powder solubility. Well, as Jenny said, I'm doing multiple jobs, multiple roles at the moment, professor of dairy science at Wageningen University, next to that also Friesland Campina in the Netherlands. Some work at Victoria University, International Dairy Journal. So in that way, involved in many things, and that's how I try to approach these topics as well from many different angles. So for looking at that, and of course, we always talk about powder solubility, powder reconstitution in many ways. I think the first thing that we really have to do, of course, is really distinguish what are we really looking at. I mean, what is it really that we're studying? What is it that we're seeing? What is our problem, or maybe not our problem at all? And if we look at it from that perspective, what we typically get is three different stages, of course, in the process. I mean, we have a powder that we put into water. We start first with basically the wetting and the sinking of the powder. We get to dispersing of the powder later, where basically our agglomerates fall apart into individual powder particles, and they will eventually dissolve. I mean, I think it's quite crucial to keep these things in mind and to really say, okay, there are different parts here. One of the things that we do see is, I mean, they're not really distinct as in one after the other, of course, time scales for these overlap. So it's not like we're gonna get wetting first and then dispersing and then dissolving. All of these will happen simultaneously. Of course, dissolving is always the last one to finish because it can't dissolve until it has dispersed as well, but really, I mean, they happen at the same time. That's something that we need to keep in mind. I think the other thing to keep in mind, most of the methods that we see that we use are typically focused on dispersing, on dispersibility. So while we often call it solubility, it's really that dispersibility that we're measuring by basically looking at separation with sieving, with filtration, with centrifugation or other means to see which part is in a soluble fraction, which part is not. And if we're looking basically at these processes and we look at that final part really of dissolution of powders, because that is of course what we want to get to at the end. I mean, at the end, we really want to get to that state where we say, well, for a milk powder, it's back in the state where it was in milk, then it takes time. Some of the things will basically dissolve very quickly. We get very quick dissolution. And you see a nice example here of some work that was done at UQ at the time on MPCs. What we see there is something like sodium, potassium, that will really dissolve very quickly. And I mean, that's basically in solution, again, in a matter of minutes. If we're looking at other constituents, if we're looking at caseins, if we're looking at calcium, phosphate, it will take a lot longer. It can take hours. And that's something that we need to keep in mind, of course, because there are different timescales involved in that whole process. And just to illustrate that as well, some work that was done at Fonterra about 20 years ago now, I think, some very nice work they did at the time is basically dissolve milk powders, some low heat, medium heat, high heat, dissolve them, and basically over the stage of more than 24 hours measure, okay, calcium, when is that in equilibrium, pH, when is that in equilibrium, and you're really looking at very long timescales. There, I mean, so there is a difference again, I think, between saying, yes, it's in solution, it is dissolved, or we're really back into an equilibrium when we're talking about dissolving powders and say we're back to the same stage where we were. I mean, we're typically talking about many hours to achieve that. It is, of course, when we're looking at processing afterwards, if we're looking at recombined milk products or these kind of things, we're not going to wait for six to 8 hours for something to be in equilibrium. So typically when we start processing these, we're at a stage where the product is not yet in equilibrium. And of course, that can have an impact as well. But as said, when we're looking at powder reconstitution, or most often we're not really looking at that final stage, that dissolving, to really say when do we get everything back to the state where it was, but it's really that dispersibility that we tend to look at. I mean, that's typically the key one analyzed. That's typically the one where we say issue or no issue. Of course, as all of you will have seen, there are many methods to look at dispersibility, but I think it's always the same principles, essentially, for looking at it. I mean, we're always pretty much looking at a proportion of material that can be separated from a soluble fraction after a given, well, combination of time, temperature, shear. I mean, we can separate that, yeah, what we call insoluble or non-dispersed fraction by centrifugation, by filtration, by sieving, by other means as well. But pretty much always that is the basis of what we're looking at in these processes. And if we start looking then at powder solubility, powder dispersibility, I think there's two things we need to look at. I mean, on the one hand, we need to distinguish between what happens during production, what happens during storage. I mean, we can lose solubility, dispersibility already during production. We can also come perfectly through production, have 100% solubility at that point, but we can lose it later on in the process during, or later on during storage of the material. So, question to ask ourselves really there is, I mean, are these really two different things, or are they basically the same reactions that are happening, but just at different speeds? Because of course, when we're looking at the production, particularly the drying process, temperatures are higher, water activity is still a bit higher, so things can happen a bit quicker, and is it just things that are slowing down later on or not? And realistically, when we look at this, I mean, when we look at solubility, dispersibility issues, it's really all about particle interactions. It's really about the casein micelles. It's about the fat globules that we have there. It's about the whey proteins. I mean, interactions between these particles, that is really what causes, well, whether a powder will dissolve or won't dissolve. So, I mean, we can see that schematically here, fat globules, casein micelles, a bit smaller, whey proteins, even smaller in the picture, of course, that, but I mean, that is what will be the cause of what we could or could not see happening. Now, if we look at something like milk powder is an interesting example, insolubility development, and really see where is it happening, where is the key, well, danger area typically that we see if we look at the process. And this is some nice work that was already done 20 years ago or more, I think, where they basically looked at skim milk concentrates and powders, different moisture contents, so you can see them ranging nicely from 3 to 50%. So basically a nice and dry powder at 3%, 50%, of course, your concentrate typically when you go on to the dryer, but also the intermediate values. Start exposing them to different time temperature combinations and basically see where does that insolubility really start happening. And what you tend to see, it's really in that area here, that 10 to 30% moisture area, so not very quickly, or not in the very initial stages of dryer, but pretty much when we've actually removed some of that water already. Combination there with a high temperature, that's really where we start forming some insolubility. And of course, we're looking there at a combination where we have a very concentrated system, but it's not so concentrated yet that we don't have any mobility or anything like that. We have high temperatures, high protein contents, of course. Because of that concentration, the pH would have decreased as well. We have high ionic strength, so we have everything together basically to say something can get unstable. So it's really that combination of what are these conditions combined with temperatures that we see in the drying process that can cause insolubility happen basically during the powder production already. And of course, one of the questions then as well is, are these the same reactions that can continue on storage or not? That's one that we'll get back to a bit later as well. If we're looking at that, I mean, this was a study done, the one that we just did in the Netherlands, but it showed that some work done in New Zealand over the years as well, looking at similar things. And again, looking at a time, for instance, to reach 6 milliliters of insolubility in a typical insolubility index measurement for skim milk powder. And again, it's that area between 10 and 30% where they do see that happening. They did the same for an MPC as well, so milk powders in the right graph, basically in, what is it, purple and white. MPC actually in the red triangles, they do see it happening there at much higher moisture content already, so in the order of 40-50%. That is where the real instability zone seems to be. Interesting though, from a moisture content, it seems different. If you calculate back that back to a protein content, it seems to be quite similar. So if we look at where the instability in the skim milk happens compared to where the instability in the MPC happens, that both seems to be about 30% protein. Of course, I mean, 30% protein, that's where we get to a very full system. Keep in mind that the casein will be binding quite a bit of water as well. So we're looking at a system that is still just about fluid, but highly concentrated. And of course, at that point, exposure to high temperature can really cause some of that aggregation. So, I mean, that's something that we really need to keep in mind during the drying process already, of course. If we remove more water, then mobility gets more restricted, so the chance of coagulation decreases a bit. But of course, something to be wary about really in that drying process when we do that. But of course, I mean, we can look at milk powders, but if we're looking at dairy powders, we get a lot more extremes basically there. And what I just try to do is basically separate them based on major constituents and see lactose, fat, ash, protein. I mean, we have powders with very high, powders with very low levels of each. I mean, if we're looking at lactose, for instance, I mean, particularly low in lactose, we might be looking at caseinates, WPI, MPI, MCI, these kind of things. But on the other hand as well, we have powders that are, of course, pure lactose. For fat, of course, many low-fat powders that we can get, but we also have powders more than 70% fat. Start thinking about cream powders, creamers, some of these kind of things, of course. Ash is an interesting as well, sometimes very low, less than 1 or 2%, but we also have powders with more than 10% ash in there. If we think about the whey powders, permeate powders, of course, protein, again. From very low to very high, in the very high range, of course, WPI, the caseinates, MPI, MCI, these kind of powders. And then within protein, we can actually start distinguishing again. I mean, is it casein, is it whey protein that it is really very high in? And even on a casein level, and we'll get into that a bit further later as well, we need to make a distinction there as well. I mean, it's not just about, is there a lot of casein there, but also is that casein in the form of casein micelles, so is it micellar casein, like we would see in MCI, MPI, these kind of products, or is it in the form of non-micellar casein that we would see in caseinate? Because that has quite a big effect as well. Because realistically, I mean, if we take that table again, and if we just start highlighting the ones where do we see most solubility issues, where can they be most extreme? I mean, it's really the MPIs, MCIs, of course, where we see a lot of that. Cream powders can be, well, very tough to deal with, as well as we all know that MPCs, MCCs, those are really the main areas where we see a lot of issues. In general, I mean, high protein, it's not bad if it's whey, if it is, for instance, whey protein, I mean, a WPI, a WPC, if treated well, will give a lot less issues. High lactose, never really a problem, but it's really often the high casein powders, and particularly high micellar casein powders, that can give some of these issues when we look at it. And that's also interesting to put next to that. Typically, I mean, of course, we have all these methods for looking at insoluble or non-dispersed fractions. I mean, what do we really see when we look at those? If we isolate that, look at composition. Well, we see small amounts of lactose in there, typically, but not a lot. Lactose typically dissolves very well. That fat, I mean, there can be quite some fat in these poorly dispersed or insoluble fractions. If we have it in whole milk powder, in cream powders, infant formula, these kind of things, then typically there is quite a bit of fat present there as well. Ash is an interesting one. I mean, there will be a bit. Typically calcium and phosphate, we will see that's associated with the caseins. Sodium, potassium, chloride, we don't see much typically in the insoluble fractions. But of course, that doesn't mean that we don't see it in insoluble powders. So they can still contribute to insolubility development. It's just not the actual sodium or potassium, for instance, that that do get there or that do remain in the insoluble parts. Protein, yes. I mean, typically substantial amounts of protein if we see insolubility. Whey protein, typically mostly when it is denatured, not as much when it is native. Casein, if we look at that, typically what we do see is casein in the form of casein micelles is more likely to end up in an insoluble fraction than casein in the form of non-micellar materials. And just to illustrate that, some work that we did on this, already 7 years ago by the looks of it, where we basically looked at milk protein concentrates, ranging in different protein contents, and started looking really, okay, what is happening both during production, but also during storage on solubility of these powders, and trying to look at that on a molecular level. And basically what we did, I mean, we did pilot production at the time, making different milk protein concentrates, starting with the 35, it's just skim milk powder, all the way up to an MPC 90, where basically we've removed pretty much all the lactose from the powder, and we're looking at protein and ash and a small bit of fat. And we made a nice range like that. I mean, 35, 50, 60, 70, 80, 85, 90. So really able to study what is happening. These were all low heat products. And for an MPC 80, we said, let's do a medium heat one as well. Heated a bit higher and see what happens when we denature whey protein. Question you would have is why not a high heat as well? And yes, that was in the planning, but something went wrong in the production, so we didn't have that one, but at least we had the medium heat from that perspective. And then we started looking really at what is happening. I mean, ash is one of these, as said before, we shouldn't just look at ash levels, but also at ash composition. And what we do see, of course, when we're looking at milk protein concentrates as a product, and typically anything that we do with filtration of milk, we lose the monovalent ones, so sodium, potassium, we very much lose in these powders. Calcium and phosphate proportionally increase, of course, because a lot of that is associated with the casein fraction. If we look at solubility, then I mean, typically what we did is store these samples at 20 degrees, 37 degrees, and 50 degrees to also take temperature effect into account. Did a fairly simple solubility test where we reconstituted it in water at a set protein content. After a set time, centrifuged to see what was soluble, what was insoluble. Well, what we tended to see, I mean, a skim milk powder, like an A here, basically nothing happening for 120 days during storage. When we look at that, the MPC 50 was stable as well. But then when we started increasing protein content bit by bit, we started forming more insolubility. What we did see there, as expected, the higher the storage temperature, the quicker it goes. The higher the protein content, the quicker it goes. So, I mean, if we're looking at a really high protein ones, or MPC 90, 85, for instance, then, well, basically within a couple of days at 50 degrees, we already created quite some insolubility. That MPC 50 on the other end, I mean, nothing happened at all. So increasing protein content, higher chance of insolubility, as expected. Started looking at it more at a molecular level then as well. Started looking at the different caseins, what happens there. So we looked at kappa casein, beta casein, alpha S1 casein, different MPCs over time. And well, basically what we tended to see there, it is not just one specific casein that is losing solubility. They're all losing solubility and it's all quite proportional. Basically, that so it didn't seem to be a specific fraction of the casein that's losing that solubility. All of them are losing it. Then we started looking at the whey protein as well in these MPCs and see what is happening there. Is that losing solubility or not? And well, make a long story short, basically there, even in the most extreme conditions, and we're looking here at G, which is our MPC 90, highest protein, highest storage temperature, where pretty much we would have lost all solubility or most of the solubility from caseinate. All that whey protein is pretty much still soluble. We lost a small bit, but really, I mean, looking at something like that, it's really driven by the caseins, the whey proteins, at least for the medium heat ones like we had here. They don't seem to be part of development of insolubility, or at least they don't end up in the insoluble fraction. Of course, as said earlier, I mean, we looked at both the low heat and the medium heat also to be able to compare what is happening when whey proteins denature. So on the left-hand side, the low heat, virtually no whey protein denaturation in there, right-hand side, the medium heat, where about 50% of the whey proteins was actually denatured. And what did we see there? Basically, I mean, we see a bit more insolubility development in medium heat, MPC 80, compared to low heat. I mean, if you look at the levels that it gets to there, and we see, of course, that whey protein that is becoming insoluble as well. We did some calculations, some modeling on it later on, and basically concluded, okay, I mean, that part that is denatured from the whey proteins, that is what really becomes insoluble. The native whey protein, so the undenatured part that was in the medium heat once, I mean, that's still dissolved quite well. So really still from that perspective, seeing that it's that the casein micelles, they really seem to be driving it. Whereas the whey proteins, they can be part of that insoluble material, but only really when they have been denatured and they're interacting with the casein fraction at that point already. Other thing that we wanted to see then is, because if we think, I mean, we see issues, for instance, in MPCs, MCIs, but if we look at something else that is very high in casein, for instance, sodium caseinate, I mean, we hardly see any insolubility issues. We really have to go quite extreme there before we see an issue. So We should look in every milk, in every MPC. Part of the caseins will be in micelles, part will be non-micellar. And does that have an impact? So we started looking basically what do we see in our materials. And indeed, we see that, of course, most of the caseins is in casein micelles, but particularly for kappa casein, we actually had some non-micellar one as well. I mean, about 20% of kappa casein that is not part of the micelles. Also a bit of beta casein, a bit of alpha-S1 casein. And we started looking, okay, once we know that, what does that mean for dissolving solubilization? And started modeling that basically, looking at correlations between total insoluble casein and either total whole casein or total micellar casein. And one of the things that we really concluded from this is if we calculated this back, I mean, it's really the caseins again in the micelles that is part of what becomes insoluble. That part of the caseins that is not in the micelles, it doesn't become insoluble. That still goes into solution in the powders. And that's what we saw, particularly for kappa casein, where we saw most or the highest level of non-micellar there. I mean, that's really where we could see that. That part, that casein that was not in the micelles, actually dissolved reasonably well. So, I mean, on work like that, what did we conclude? Well, of course, that we needed high protein content for insolubility. I mean, at low protein content, basically, we didn't see much happening at all. We saw that the micellar caseins are really, in this case, the main cause to insolubility. Whey proteins only contribute when denatured, but caseins that was not in the form of casein micelles or the non-micellar casein actually remains soluble, which is of course in line when we think of something like sodium caseinate that well, we have to abuse pretty badly before we can actually start causing insolubility there. That, of course, I mean, you get conclusions, you also get questions really. And I mean, why is there that protective effect at lower protein content? So if you look at the SMP, the MPC50, why don't we see anything developing there? I mean, why do we see a protective effect of non-micellar casein and what drives that interaction between casein micelles? And maybe first, I mean, that protective effect of low protein content, why don't we see anything happening there? What we quite simply think is it's lactose. I mean, if you think about it, if you look at it, of course, I mean, in a skim milk powder, we're looking at about 35 protein, about 50 lactose. If you try to visualize a particle like that more on a, well, micro scale, something like that, you're looking at a lactose matrix with proteins dispersed in there. So, I mean, there's quite a bit of space between the proteins. They're not touching or anything like that. On the other hand, if you look at an MPC 85 or something like that, I mean, pretty much all the lactose is gone. So it's really protein on protein. It's all the proteins are directly interacting. So if we're looking at protein aggregation, protein interactions as the main cause for insolubility, then of course it is a lot more likely to be happening there in, well, basically a sample that doesn't have protective work or protective areas there from the lactose. Looking at that effect of non-micellar casein, actually a very nice study done a couple of years ago in China at Jiangnan University. I mean, what they basically did is they took milk, they pre-acidified it to different pHs between 5.4 and 6.7, started doing ultrafiltration to produce an MPC from that. Then they either kept pH as it was after the ultrafiltration or brought it back to 6.7 and started looking at drying it and then started looking basically at what happens during to the properties of the MPCs and seeing some quite nice things. I mean, one of the main things that I really see in this is what happens when they do that pre-acidification and ultrafiltration at low pH. They remove a lot of the calcium. That and pretty much, I mean, the one where they went to pH 5.4, then did ultrafiltration, diafiltration, they could remove about 80% of all the calcium compared to an equivalent SMP that they would get. So hardly any soluble calcium there, which is what you would expect, of course, for an MPC. And also the colloidal calcium, so the part associated with the casein, that really got very low. So, and what I see from that perspective as well, I mean, all of the casein or a lot of the casein in these samples where a lot of calcium has been removed is actually soluble. So it's not casein micelles anymore. It has actually gone into a non-micellar form. Probably similar to what you see in caseinate, but can't quite say it for sure from what they see. I mean, if you look at that under an electron microscope, some nice images. I mean, if you look at the skim milk powder as a control, then we typically see the casein micelles that we would want to expect to see there, a couple of hundred nanometers. If we look at these materials that have been pre-acidified, ultrafiltration, diafiltration, as you can see, there's nothing left of those casein micelles. Very small casein particles. That's all that's left. So it's complete disruption, really. And if they start looking then at solubility, what happens during drying? What happens over time? I mean, their control MPC that they had basically at a starting pH of 6.7, I mean, if when they store that, that lost solubility quite a bit. I mean, going down to about 20% solubility, which is interesting. I mean, we keep seeing that a lot. That is typically the whey protein that is still soluble at 20% of total protein. A lot of the casein that's gone. On the other end, these ones where they had removed calcium, where they had created more non-micellar casein, they stay nice and soluble. No big issues happening over time, really. So it's really that combination what they do of course, removing calcium by pre-acidification and then the filtration, combining that with restoring pH again. I mean, that really improves that stability, creates something that contains quite a bit of non-micellar casein. I mean, this is one example where they did it basically for where they used acidification before membrane filtration to do this. There's several other examples as well, or quite a few other examples in literature. Others have done similar things with pre-acidification, maybe using different acids, different conditions, but the trends are the same. Addition of calcium sequestering agents can be done as well. Think about, for instance, people adding citrate to materials before this, before filtration or after filtration as well, to bind a lot of the calcium. Treatment with cation exchange resins to remove some of the calcium and disrupt the casein micelles there as well. I mean, all these ones are done as well, have been described in literature, some in patents as well, and really show that nice link there as well. So if we're looking at that, if we're looking at calcium depletion, I mean, really what we see, and we see that consistently in all studies done, is that calcium depletion leads to reduced insolubility development both during drying and during storage. I mean, two potential mechanisms there that we can think about. I mean, one is really that disruption of casein micelles create that non-micellar casein. The other one is basically lowering of soluble calcium levels, having less calcium in solution. Will that improve stability? What it seems to be is that under, well, let's call it normal circumstances, if you don't do anything too strange, too extreme, it's really that first one, that disruption or partial disruption of the casein micelles that really can help in creating additional stability to insolubility development. final one that I wanted to talk a bit about is fat, because of course, I mean, a lot about protein. Protein really being the driver, but we also see poor solubility sometimes in products containing quite a bit of fat. I mean, whole milk powder is an example that I have no idea why I wrote skim milk powder there, but that should be cream powder. That's another example where we do see a bit of insolubility, or quite a bit of insolubility in bad cases, and really thinking then about what is that role of fat. And I mean, if we look at the comparison whole milk powder versus skim milk powder, for instance, I mean, we know, of course, that lactose content is lower in whole milk powder. So from that perspective, from what we said earlier, does that mean that lactose is, that we get so little lactose that we get protein interaction? But I think we have to be realistic there, because protein to lactose ratio, which is actually the more dominant one, is similar. So that on its own is unlikely to make whole milk powder more susceptible. On the other hand, of course, I mean, what do we do in a whole milk powder manufacturer? We homogenize, and it leads to basically a larger fraction of particles, a larger surface area of material being stabilized by protein. So we pretty much get a bigger surface area available for potential aggregation. And we do see something similar really there as well. If we look at heat stability, heat-induced coagulation of milk. If we look there, I mean, whole milk will typically have a lower heat stability than skim milk, assuming that it is homogenized. Unhomogenized doesn't make much difference. Once it is homogenized, once we create that extra surface area, then we get lower or higher chances of instability during heating. And it seems like we see similar things happening in there. The other one that we have to consider when we're talking about fat is also component distribution in powders. Because what we do see, and I mean, this is an example from MPCs and milk powders where we looked at surface and bulk composition. But you see the same if you look at a WPC or an infant formula or other things. Proportionally, there is a lot more fat on the surface, really on the surface of powders, than there is in the bulk of the powder. So there seems to be a specific enrichment of fat on the surface. And well, of course, fat and water are not the biggest friends when we talk about that. So it can have quite a big impact on reconstitution from that perspective as well. I mean, you can look at it as well. If you look at the whole milk powder in a confocal microscope, visualize the fat in orange that you see there. I mean, we do see quite some patches really of fat, destabilized emulsion that we get on the surface of these particles. And you can see that quite nicely as well. I mean, if you look at a milk powder initially, a whole milk powder, and you wash it afterwards with, or you wash it with an organic solvent and you look afterwards, you really see these areas where quite a bit of the fat actually has been. And I mean, what we do see there is, I mean, that fat on the surface, of course, it can hinder the interaction with water. It can really start causing some issues, that insolubility. And you see that quite nicely here as well. I mean, some work from France from some years ago, looking at powders where they look both at surface fat over time and wetting time over time. And what they do see is during storage, they tend to get some increases in surface fat in these powders. And that really leads to an increase in wetting time as well, because of course that fat on the surface of the powder, not ideal to say the least. That is what comes into contact with water. It won't dissolve very well. So you will get some issues there as well. I mean, if we want to control that, if we want to make sure that we don't get these issues, then of course, a lot of it is about insolubility, making sure that we homogenize properly, making sure that we get the right protein stabilized fat globules that are nice and stable, of course, in a milk powder. Not too difficult. I mean, plenty of protein to cover all that fat. Once we start looking at infant formulas, of course, it starts getting a bit more tricky because we have less protein over fat, of course, and a lot more of the protein is whey protein. So that's another one there that we need to look at. Looking, of course, at what happens as well during drying and really seeing there that higher inlet temperatures can actually help in reducing free fat. Lower outlet temperatures can help a bit there as well. Lactose crystallization, something to really be wary about and prevent, because that can start causing the issues. It can really start damaging the fat globules, get free fat. And of course, what we see as well, of course, I mean, get your atomization right typically, because it's the small particles, it's the fines that will typically contain a lot of the free fat and can kind of give the issues from that perspective as well. I mean, of course, it's not just solubility, it's flowability and other powder handling properties as well, where you see some issues, some quite big issues really there as well. I mean, high free fat, not controlling the fat basically in the samples can give you quite some issues from that perspective. And I mean, just to finish off at the end of this, a bit of looking to the future. And I think what's one of the key things when we look at this, but when we look at many of the areas, basically, I think of dairy science in general, it's really looking at that balance between, on the one hand, fundamental insights, and basically say, of course, we want to know everything, we want to understand everything, but how do we put that as well into practical control parameters? So we really need to keep that balance between, on the one hand, the scientific depth and the practical application. I think there is, in this area, but also in other areas, a cautionary tale that perhaps sometimes we keep reinventing the wheel. I mean, there's been an awful lot of work done in the last century, and we can actually use a lot of that. We can use a lot of that quite well. And I mean, that also goes for powder drying and insolubility, that an awful lot of work in the 1970s, 1980s, that's for some reason we tend to forget, again, from time to time. And of course, I mean, in some of these studies that we see in literature, very interesting to see scientific literature, of course, but we need to consider as well whether, well, we can realistically do this in a factory. Everything that is interesting is not automatically relevant. But I think once we understand basically what is happening in these powders, then we can actually come up with a good practical control measures as well. And with that, thanks very much for your attention. And of course, more than happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay, thanks so much, Tom. Right, we'd now like to open it up for questions. If you have any, please type them into the chat box. Make sure you type them to everybody, and Tom will be able to answer them with a bit of luck. Hey, Tom. That was great. Gee, you've done a lot of research into that, Tom. That's excellent.
Oh, yeah. And the fun still continues.
So we'll just give it a couple of minutes and see if somebody comes up with a question or two. Pause the recording. Tom, typically we would get a few questions here. Maybe people are having a think about it. But should they wish to contact you via email, is that all right to do that?
Yeah, no problem at all.
Yeah, I know you're a very busy man. There's a question there now.
Yeah.
So if you can just read the question out, please, and then answer.
Yeah, just reading it now. Thanks for the presentation. Are you able to comment on the difference between adding lecithin into the oil blend versus lecithination on free fat? Yeah. So basically, if we look at that, of course, difference between adding it to the oil blend and lecithination is really looking at where will the lecithin end up. If we add lecithin to the oil blend, then it will typically end up on the interface of the emulsion droplets. So we get protein there, we get some lecithin there as well. On the other hand, I mean, if we add it to the, if we use it purely for lecithination, it will end up on the surface of the powder particle. In the first case, I mean, that combination of lecithin and protein on the interface, it can help improve your emulsion stability. It can prevent potential damage to the fat globules during the further process, and it should help you reduce some free fat formation. In the second case, I mean, lecithinization, if we do that, if we're spraying it on only at that stage, it's not going to do much for you in terms of free fat. What it's really going to do for you there, of course, is help with dispersibility and wetting. So if you want to use it from the perspective of reducing free fat content, it's really a matter of making sure that it's on the emulsion droplets and make sure that you get a stable emulsion with that. Yeah, see another one there from Bernie. Has there been much work done on preventing fat protein aggregation through the evaporator? Not a whole load of work done there. I mean, there's been a few studies done in that area. I think most notable, some work from New Zealand in the early 2000s. Looking at what really happens to fat and protein and the aggregation in an evaporator. Basic conclusion, I think, is if you do things well, not a whole lot happens. And you're actually able to increase or to at least keep your protein stable. You might get a bit of damage to your emulsion droplets in the evaporator. That if you go towards extreme conditions, then there can be some damage. Looking at the emulsion stability, potential damage that you might get in the evaporator, there is of course the question is where do you place your homogenizer? Because having a homogenizer there after after the evaporator can be quite beneficial there in making sure that your fat is stabilized as well as possible and you're not going to get issues during the drying at that point. Yeah, see one from Shane there. Thanks for the presentation. Can you talk to using hydrolyzed ingredients in infant formula and if there's any benefit on product properties? Oh, that's a broad one. If we look in general, of course, I mean, when we start looking at using hydrolyzed ingredients compared to intact protein, from an emulsification perspective, it gets more difficult. I mean, the peptides don't stabilize the emulsions as well as the intact proteins would. I mean, if it's mildly hydrolyzed, you get away with it. If it's extensively hydrolyzed, then you really have to start looking for alternative emulsifiers as well, because you can't stabilize the fat otherwise. From a stability to coagulation, more of a heat stability perspective, there do tend to be the the hydrolysates do tend to have somewhat higher stability. So there you could have benefits. So it's a bit of a balance between, on the one hand, protein aggregation, on the other hand, looking at emulsion stability. For emulsion stability, it would be negative. For protein aggregation, there can be some benefits. So it's, yeah, kind of a bit of a trade-off. And it's making sure that you have the right hydrolysates, of course, that can handle both. On the overall thing, yeah, I mean, with the mild hydrolysates, you can still do quite a bit. With the extensive hydrolysates, you really go in a complete redesign there. Need to get a different emulsion, need to do a lot of things different to be able to produce something that is stable.
We don't seem to have any more questions there. If you do have further questions, you are welcome to, you see Tom's email there on the final slide, so you can contact him directly, and I'm sure he'll be able to help. Tom, you're one very, very clever man, and we're absolutely privileged to have you here today.
All right. Thanks very much.
Okay, then. Thanks so much.